So, welcome back to another podcast episode where we help aspiring developers get jobs and junior developers grow. In this episode, we're going to be talking about another aspiring developer story. Jessica, who was on one of our previous podcast episodes, the Rhythm one, she finally got a job, which is awesome. And we're going to talk about how that job search went and hopefully dive into some advice for other aspiring developers out there. Jessica, welcome back. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. Thank you. How are you?
I'm really good. Life is good. And congrats on the new position, by the way.
Thank you.
So, I like seeing success stories. And I also like learning about how they happened. So, let's just dive into this. Well, maybe we should do a quick intro because some people might not have seen the previous episode. So, introduce yourself.
Yeah, sure. So, hi, I'm Jessica. I am a software engineer at Flowcast. Prior to Flowcast, I did a boot camp called Rhythm, and that was a four-month program. And then after I graduated, I found a job within a month. So that's awesome. Been my engineering story.
Yeah, that's a really that's a really short time frame for getting a job. So I can't wait to hear how you actually did that. But I guess let's just start with a generic question: what was your job search like?
I got very lucky. My job search was thankfully not as grueling as I know it can be. I reached out a lot to my network and kind of, you know, talked to other engineers and just had a lot of opportunities to interview with companies that were, you know, within my network. And so that was really cool.
Okay, so when you reached out, what did your messages look like? How'd you
work? So the first message I got actually was like, my LinkedIn post was like, hey, I'm doing this new engineering thing. And somebody reached out to me through that post. I had never met him. He worked at the same company I did, but like 10 years prior to me. And he was like, hey, there's this front end engineer role. Do you want to interview for it? And I was like, sure. And I interviewed for that and it went terribly. I did not get the job, but it was still really, it was still a learning experience for me because that was the first time I was talking about myself as an engineer. And so I was really nervous. I didn't really know how to craft my engineering story. So, you know, even though I didn't get it, I thought it was still, you know, very valuable to me.
Why do you feel like you didn't do well?
I was so nervous. He was like, so, like, tell me about your experience with React. And he's like, this is the React only role. I was like, yeah, React. I learned it in my boot camp. So I at that point, I was like, I should learn more React.
Did you have any projects on your, did you have a portfolio website?
I do. So I started building that before I ended my bootcamp. And so I have my website up, but I didn't have any like projects that weren't done during the bootcamp. So then after that interview, I was like, oh, I should really practice some React. And so I built like a single page React app in like a week or so, and you know, I was able to slap that onto my portfolio too.
Do you feel like that application helped you in the job search?
I think it did, but not in the way most people expect. I think technically it was not a very difficult project, but I think it showed that I you know, had some initiative to do this project on my own. And I used the Pokemon API, so I was like very passionate about it. And so I think that passion and that, you know, really came through of like, you know, I'm building this cool thing and I'm tying it in with my childhood nostalgia. So I think like that, in that sense, it helps me, but technically it was not a very difficult project.
Okay. I feel like a lot of software engineers can just reminisce about Pokemon and be like, oh yeah, I get it. Right? It makes sense. That's pretty cool. Okay. So do you mind? Because I think I think it'd be really helpful if people could see the LinkedIn post, see your portfolio. And I think people are really curious, like, okay, what was a portfolio? What did that portfolio look like for a person that got a job? What was their LinkedIn post like? Do you mind if I link those? Okay.
Yeah, of course. So, should I give it to you like later?
Yeah, give it to me later. I'll link it in the description, but I let me know if this isn't valuable, but I'm going to link it. I think it's going to be valuable. So you got a job within a month. Like you mentioned that you got lucky. Why do you feel like you got lucky?
Yeah, so I utilize my network a lot, and a lot of the time I would just reach out to engineers in my network and be like, hey, do you have any tips for me? And, you know, a lot of people said, grind LEET code. So I was like, oh, gotta do the LEET code.
Yeah.
But sometimes, once in a while, they'd be like, oh, my company is actually hiring. Like, I'll put in a referral for you. And that happened 3 times. So I got 3 referrals, I got 3 technical interviews, and I got a job from one of them.
Wow. To me that, I mean, maybe you're just being humble. To me, that doesn't sound like luck. That feels like you get the result of networking. It feels like, you know, you were proactive about it. You connected with people. A lot of people are shy to do that, and they don't know what to say, and they're kind of nervous, or they're going to make a fool of themselves, or they're wasting their time. A lot of different reasons people won't reach out for, but you did that. What made you think that was going to be a good idea, or that you should do it?
I did that simultaneously while I was just throwing my application out into the wild. And I was like, you know what? I gotta come at this from 2 fronts. Like, I just gotta go wide, but then I also want to try to like go a little bit focused and see, you know, like, and part of it was, I actually want to hear about their experience, or, you know, my friends is, right, my network's advice for me, or like what their experience was graduating from a boot camp, or how they found a job. And so part of it was like, you know, I genuinely want this advice, because they are sick, they have an engineering job, they did something right.
Right. Yeah. Okay. That's pretty good. And that's proactive. I like that you did that. And that's probably why you got the position so fast. So I want to cover both interviews. You had mentioned you went through an interview and you did poorly because you were nervous. And I've had several of those, by the way, so I can relate. But I want to walk through that interview and the interview for your current position. Now, I want to stress, don't talk about the specific problems, because I think a lot of those get leaked and then, you know, managers have to spend a long time. But if you would, just kind of walk through how that first interview process went, where you were really nervous.
Yeah, so it was more just like a call with the hiring manager, and he was just like, oh, hey, I'm looking for somebody on this, my team, to build these React widgets. And I didn't know what to say. part of it was like, maybe I don't know enough about React to talk about React. And then part of it was, I don't know how to craft my story. You know, we practiced it at the end of my boot camp, but it was a totally different thing doing it live versus, you know, doing it with my cohort mates, where nothing's at stake. So I just got really nervous, and I just couldn't talk about myself, couldn't talk about React.
So did you make it past that phone screening?
I did not.
Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting. What about the second interview? How did that go with your current position?
So my current position was my first technical interview.
Okay.
I straight up told the interviewer, like, this is my first time doing a technical interview. I'm a little bit nervous. And he was so nice. He was like, don't worry, this is only my second time interviewing, so we both be nervous.
That's awesome.
And I think that's when I kind of knew, like, okay, this is a company that I would want to work for.
Why?
Just having that personable, like having somebody relate to you, you know. Okay. He was just very personable, and I felt like, you know, he's interviewing, so he probably has some say in, you know, who gets hired. And if he's very like reasonable and like patient, I'm sure the other hiring council will, you know, have similar values. So like, okay, I'm going to try harder. I'm going to try for this one.
Okay. So that's interesting. So when you kind of felt that connection, you felt more confident, and you also, it sounds like you put more effort into it. And you know, that's a realistic thing. Sometimes you do get a position from, even if we're going back to who you apply for, if you're just sending out a bunch of, or sending out your resume and doing a bunch of cold applications, sometimes you will get a job. But there are, and I think it's important to emphasize, when there is a company that you feel like your values align, the product aligns, stuff like that, you put some extra effort in. And so, I mean, you only have so much time. So, okay, so he kind of made you feel comfortable. He's relatable. He's humble, it sounds like. Did you get to meet other members of the team before you were hired?
Yes, I did. So that was the first technical screen. And then, you know, it was either pass or fail. And I passed through to the next round. And then I met a couple of hiring managers and a couple of senior engineers there. And, you know, just went through the pipeline with the interviewing there.
It's interesting meeting other departments. I remember in my interview meeting with product, and I'm like, I have no idea what to say to product. And I remember meeting with QA and design. I'm like, I don't know what to say to you. And I did my best to just like try to have a conversation. I connect and I ask questions, but I'm like, I also heard some interesting questions from them that I hadn't thought of. So in your interview with these other departments,
they're all engineers. Just, they were all, yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. My bad. I misheard.
Oh, no worries. Then, I might have misspoken.
what was a question they asked you that just surprised you? You didn't think they were going to ask?
I think during one of my interviews, somebody asked me about the implementation of one of my projects, and I didn't really know how to answer. I was like, you know, he asked me, oh, like, what was the issue here? Like, how did you solve this problem? I was like, I don't remember. I wrote this code so long ago. I mean, I didn't say that, but I was like, you know, I think the person I paired with, we had disagreements on the implementation, and I just couldn't remember. Then I went back to the code, and I was like, oh my God, I remember now. We had to prevent SQL injection. I should, man, you know. So that was kind of a question that kind of threw me. I was like, I didn't think that they would dig so deep.
Yeah, that's... Well, that's kind of cool that you handled that. You spent some time thinking about that. Some people would just be like, I don't remember. I don't know. And like, that's a really important conversation to have when you, I guess, okay, maybe I'm going to rant and maybe this is advice, but implementation questions happen often in interviews. You know, engineers want to know why you implemented it in a certain way. They want to hear your process. And I think some people kind of freeze up, and sometimes even the project they built like 6 months ago, they get embarrassed. They're like, I don't even want to tell this person why I implemented it this way, right? But having a conversation and trying to, give some sort of response or talk about it a bit, or even just take like 2 seconds to review the code, I think that's awesome, because a lot of people will freeze up there. So it sounds like overall you enjoyed the team. They liked you, obviously. They hired you, right? What do you feel like made you stand out amongst all other applicants? This isn't the time to be humble. Okay, go.
I think part of it was just how I carry myself and how, you know, I was super excited to talk about the Pokemon project. I'm going to keep going to that project. It's very not impressive, but I think me talking about that project and talking about like having to do that outside of the boot camp and learning how to, you know, do all these different things through that project, I think that really helped me stand out as a candidate of like, oh, she's passionate. She genuinely enjoys making things. And she made this thing by herself because she wanted to, and not because, you know, she had to.
So that's okay. You know, that's really cool to hear. So it was just about like your interest and passion and curiosity, and it showed through a Pokemon project. So, you know, for all the people that have been giving me crap for my mock interview, my front end, we did a Pokemon app. We had the applicant build it. It does happen. These interviews actually happen. Employers care about it. Employers can relate to it. And I think it's quirky. It's like, it's a fun, quirky thing, and it's interesting. This is what's interesting. If that manager liked Pokemon in the past, that's relatable. You wouldn't think so. You're like, oh, this person's probably just like business oriented. It's like, no, they had a childhood, they had a past. You'd be surprised at how many engineers are like, this is kind of cool, you know?
Yeah.
I think that was a good choice. So thank what you. Do you think was the most frustrating part of your job search?
Oh my God, it was throwing out all those applications and getting nowhere. You know, I cold applied to a lot of jobs through LinkedIn or Indeed. And I would tailor my cover letter to the job description. I'd have like, okay, they're looking for, you know, GraphQL and, you know, so such and such and such and such. And I would talk about my experience or, you know, and even though I spent time crafting, you know, redoing my cover letter, crafting it to the job description, like, I think I only got one interview from that. And I didn't do well. You know, like, I think that was the most frustrating part, was I felt like I was spending a lot of time doing something that had no, like, final result. Like, the final result was just nothing.
So you felt like you were putting way too much effort into cover letters, which wasn't really giving you a good result?
Yeah, exactly. I was putting a lot of effort into cover letters and sending out my resume to cold, and, you know, I only got one interview from it.
So what did you highlight on your resume? What did you put at the top? What did you put at the bottom?
Yeah, so my resume is just like a chronological resume. So my top was like my internship experience, and then like after that was my non-engineering job descriptions. But I, on like the right side, or maybe the left side, I forget now, I highlighted like which specific engineering technologies I'm familiar with. So like, oh, I'm familiar with REST API, but I'm also familiar with GraphQL. I can do JavaScript and I can do Python, you know, just stuff like that.
Okay. Did you prioritize your skills based on how comfortable you were with them? Like, order them?
I think I just listed them based on like front end, back end, testing, other.
Okay. Did you have a, what do you call it? Just like a abstract, a description of what you were looking for. Like, you know, I'm looking for a front end position, blah, 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 blah. A lot of people include that at the top.
Oh, I think I just put full stack developer.
Okay. So you kept it short and concise.
Yeah. Yeah.
Gotcha. Even if you apply to front end or back end positions, you put full stack.
Yep. Yep.
Okay. Cool. Did you list your education?
I did. I believe I listed my bootcamp first and then my degree.
Okay. All right. Interesting. I really need to just like put together all these resumes of people that get developer jobs and what their final resume look like. It would be interesting aggregating that data. I guess it's
a lot of ours would look very similar. I think I just use like the Google like template.
It's all just from one random Google template that everyone uses. Okay. Maybe I'll squash that idea. Okay.
I mean, that's what I did. And I know a lot of my cohort mates did that.
Okay. Fair enough. So that's really cool. You got through the interview, and I almost feel like you did really well just because the interviewer made you feel comfortable. I see that a lot. You know, that's really important. What was your first day like?
My first day, oh my goodness, I think I didn't even meet my team. I met my manager's manager, and he just kind of went through some docs with me, and he was like, okay, this is a 30-60 day plan, this is your first week plan. And I was like, okay, I'm gonna try to absorb all of this. And he's like, oh, by the way, make sure you have access to Okta, Jira, you know, all these other things. And I was like, okay.
Did it feel a little overwhelming on your first day?
I think that's normal onboarding stuff. But it did almost feel overwhelming because it was like, I knew I had to dive into the code base at some point. And I think that was really scary. Like, I think when I first took a look at the code base on my first ticket, my first paired ticket, I was like, thank God I'm paired with somebody.
Okay. So they did pairing initially. Yeah. What is your official title?
I am a software engineer one.
Software engineer one. Okay. All right, really cool. You had mentioned, I don't know if you mentioned it on the episode, but I know before that your cohort played a big role.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Can you elaborate on that?
Yeah, of course. So after we finished the boot camp, my cohort, you know, we decided to all be very supportive of each other during our job search because it's brutal. And so we all decided to do self-led weekly check-ins. We did leak code practices. In the early stages, we would do like behavioral interviews with each other just to like kind of refine talking about our experience, talking about ourselves. And then I also met with somebody to do technical interviewing because I had bombed a technical interview so bad. I was like, I need your help. Please, please help me with this technical interview. Like, throw the book at me, ask me all of the JavaScript trivia questions. And I think that really helped. Like, it helped having that support network of everybody else is struggling. And you know, I hate to see you struggle, but it's also nice to see that I'm not the only one struggling.
Right. Yeah, you kind of feel a little guilty. You're like, oh, wait, what did I just... I'm glad you're struggling, but I'm struggling too. We're doing it together. But it gives you, at least for me, I felt a little guilty about it when I would see someone like, man, I didn't get that position. You know, that sucked. I really wanted this. And part of me is like, I really hope you get it. And part of me is like, okay, I'm not the only one. You know, it was kind of a relief. So I felt a little guilt for that, but it's relatable, right? And everyone struggles in that job search.
Yeah, for sure. And just being able to like, practice with them really helped too. You know, like the leak code practice, the interview practice, or the behavioral interview practice, the technical practice, like all of that I think really helped me. You know, because I talked about myself a lot and practiced a lot. Because after I bombed that first one, I was like, I need to practice talking about myself. if you can try, this is my advice, is like, if you're a new developer, definitely try to tap in and get a support network. I think that's super, super helpful.
Yeah. And, you know, a lot of people don't have money for coding boot camps, and you can still get that support network. I mean, you being proactive on LinkedIn, I hope more people choose to, you know, put themselves out there like that, because that's how you build it, right? You like build that network on LinkedIn, go to meetups, you know, do hackathons, just do join developer communities. There's so much out there, and I think people push it off, but I'm glad you really emphasized this, because I feel like the developers that do have this support usually are the ones that don't give up when you do build that.
There was a dev community that I joined towards the end of my boot camp, and the lady who runs it is, she's amazing. She does like workshops a lot, and she has weekly you know, calendar meetups where you just go in and just be like, oh man, I didn't do so well, or hey, you know, what can I do to improve, or you know, it, just having that community, like it's totally like, the, can I say the name?
Yeah.
Okay. I wasn't sure. It's called Year One. And I thought that was just so helpful to have. And I was able to practice my technical skills with the person who runs the program. And, you know, she just hosts a lot of events, and I definitely go to them. You're definitely going to meet other people who are in the same boat as you.
Okay. Well, shout out to them. That's really cool. I like hearing about communities like that. All right. I think I got a feel for your experience, and I hope it's helpful to people. But, you know, really what I got out of it was support networks are incredibly helpful. And I've said this statistic before, but I used to host a mentorship meetup in Chicago, and 85 to 90% of people that would come to my meetup, they would make a little progress, but they would eventually give up. And I feel like a lot of developers give up, but I did have a lot of self-taught developers that came my way. So it's, I think more self-taught developers than anything give up, but I think it's so crucial to get that support network and just a community that vibes. Like, don't get discouraged. Like, if you join a community, if you connect with people on LinkedIn, you're like, this didn't help me at all, or I don't really vibe with this community. Like, there are so many others out there. Like, keep trying and find the community that's right for you.
But, yeah, definitely.
Well, congratulations on the new position.
Thank you.
I want to ask you one more question.
Sure.
So, if you had to give one final piece of advice for aspiring developers, what would it be? And you can't reuse what you said last time.
Oh, no. I was just going to reuse it.
Nope. I don't even remember what it was, but you can't reuse it.
I think the best advice I can give is, you know, tap into your network. I know that worked for me, and don't be afraid to tap into your network. We're always going to be happy to talk. Like, some of the people that I reached out to, they were like, oh my gosh, hey, I haven't heard from you in like 2 years. That's so great to see you're doing engineering. How can I help? Like, people are going to be way more friendly than you think they might. And, you know, I just definitely reach out to your network. You can reach out to me.
Perfect. Well, that's a good segue into our outro. If people wanted to reach out to you, where could they reach you?
Yes, I am on LinkedIn. And I'll give Dawn the link, and you can put it in your description.
Okay, I'll do that. Well, Jessica, thank you so much for giving me your time again. I hope this is helpful for people. But yeah. Thanks for coming on.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Tom. Good luck, everybody.